Okay, Luke chapter 2, verse 47. Let's get right into this morning. Good morning, everybody. High five your neighbor. Say, you're still looking great. I don't know what you drank, but it does look good on you. Amen. Luke chapter 2, verse 47. It pops up. Everyone read out loud. Ready? Read. And all who heard him were astonished at his understanding and his answers. We've primarily been talking about relationships and marriage and relationships in terms of friendships and the guy-girl kind of thing, you know. And so today I'm going to kind of come at this a little bit on that topic, but I want to focus in on a word that was kind of born in me in prayer this week. You know, Jesus came with the sole purpose to rescue what I would consider history's biggest problem when it came to a relationship. That was a relationship with the Heavenly Father and his creation called humanity. And Jesus himself was a problem solver without any question. That's why he came to this earth. He came to change our story. He came to bring answers. Now, every relationship, every marriage, whether it's friendship or that new beginning of a romantic relationship or however it goes, has its problems, has its difficulties. Can I have an amen? Amen. Or an oh me? I'll take either one. But I want you to understand, it's important that you and I understand. Now, the key of what I want to share with you this morning is found in something that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6. And I want to talk to you about how to conquer problems more on a general level. We've been talking about in the last couple of weeks resolving conflict in a relationship. Let me broaden this a little bit. Let me assure hearts here this morning of what God wants to do in your life. And it is something good. Amen. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 22 and 23 from the NIV, it says, "The eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness." You know, again, I repeat to you that we face problems. Because you have a problem in your life, it doesn't mean you should become a problem person. But we all face problems. It doesn't make you bad. It doesn't make you evil. It doesn't make you wrong. It doesn't make you out of sorts with God. But sometimes we don't understand problems, whether it be a relationship or in life. And the worst thing you can do is to retaliate and to be hasty with your reactions on how to resolve that problem. And sometimes the problem seems to be the biggest thing in our life. The first key, I think, to overcoming any kind of problem is don't become problem-minded. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't become problem-minded now. You know, problems, really what a problem is, it's a picture, a negative picture, a dark picture on the inside of you. And it's important that you don't become so problem-minded that you cannot see the answer that God has for you. Like if this room were to go completely dark, I mean completely dark, like immediately. I was thinking on doing that, but I might startle some of you. But anyways, the doors were closed and there was no illumination on the media and some of the, I mean, this room gets like pitch dark. You can't even like see a few feet in front of you. That's how dark it gets. Now, me knowing, I still know that I'm on a stage, and if I walk too far in the wrong direction, I'm going over the edge. And if I keep on walking, assuming I made it that far, I'd probably walk into some of you, because you're still here. Now, just because it's dark doesn't mean that that you're not here. And this is what I want to share with you, that when Jesus said about how we look at things in life, he said, the eye is the lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. If your eyes are bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. Darkness is not necessarily truth, but if your mind is only set on the darkness or the problem, you won't see the truth. But all you have to do is switch on the light, and all of a sudden, I see all of you, peekaboo. And I want you to understand that, you know, how we see things makes a huge difference on the outcome of our lives. And Jesus said, there's two ways that you can look at life, two ways you can look at problems. You are either going to see it through a good eye, which will give you light, which is based on on Jesus Christ and based on his word, or you're going to look at it through a bad eye, which is to be what I would refer to in this setting, being problem-minded and looking at it always as a negative outcome. It's not that we can't turn on the light on all situations. There's not a problem that God does not have an answer for. So problems can seemingly blind us or cause an illusion that there are no answers because it is so dark. And remember, we're not denying the facts that you might be facing a problem, a dark moment, a dark season. But the facts are always trumped by the truth. And the truth overcomes the facts of life. We're not in denial of anything, but it's when you turn on the light. Turning on the light is, what does God's word say? What does Jesus say? And what I like to get people to understand is, you cannot win a victory when the problem is the biggest thing in your life. See, if the problem is the biggest thing in your life, it's going to be very difficult for you to win the victory, to get the triumph, to come with the resolution. So what we need to do is to become promise-minded, right? God-word-minded. All the promises of God are yes and amen. See, all the promises of God, 2 Corinthians 1:20, all the promises of God are yes and amen. As long as you and God are in agreement, you got your answer. And the thing is, the adversary is going to try to darken you. Now, where he tries to darken you is because you can't figure it out. But I'll tell you right now, you never were that smart to begin with. Your neighbor might not know that, but you might want to let him know. But see, when Jesus is not the biggest thing, when I say when Jesus is not the biggest thing, that can sound churchy. I don't mean to be that, but I mean to say this. When Jesus Christ is not the center of your life, is not the core of your life, you know, when his word is not the center of your life, your number one, your focus, problems in your life will be magnified, and you will drift over to become problem-minded. So problem-minded that you get negative and cynical about the outcome of your life, when all the time, all you have to do is wake up and Jesus Christ will give you light. A spiritual law is this. You know, problems tend to bring hard times, don't they? And some of you may be going through a hard time right now. Maybe a problem in your marriage, a problem in a relationship, a problem on your career path, a problem with your spiritual walk with God. Not where you want to be. You kind of know that. Or it could be an emotional thing. It could be a doctor's report. It could be an economic report in your life. It could be, you know, just a number of various, you know, situations. It's important that you learn that what Jesus said to you and I is valuable. The eye is a lamp of the body. If your eyes are good, your whole body will be full of light. Being full of light is expectant and confident that you're going to break through. There is no such thing as a relationship, a marriage that's problem-free. It doesn't exist. But the thing is, we have answers, astounding answers. Jesus understands not only Arturo Sepulveda, Covarrubias, Chico Chico, Barrio Jimenez Sanchez, that's me, and he understands you, whatever your name is, Chemo, you know, or Pocahontas, however we want to go at this one. But listen, here's a spiritual truth that you must remember. When hard times come, they are never as hard as they look. When hard times come, they are never as hard as they look. But when they come, they look hard. So I'm not in denial that when a problem arises, that it doesn't look hard, but they're never as hard as they look. It all depends how you're looking at your problem. Okay, so let me say it to you this way. When hard times come, they're never as hard as they look, unless you're looking in the wrong place, looking through the wrong set of eyes, thinking the wrong thoughts, and imitating the wrong people. You see, wrong thoughts are thoughts that are not based on God's promise. They're just simply based on your senses and how you feel. That's why we walk by faith and not by sight. God says, while we look not at the things which are seen, problem, circumstances, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen, the natural problem, circumstance, are subject to change. High five your neighbor, say, I think this is going to be good for you. Wrong thoughts, dwelling on wrong thoughts, tell you things are worse than they really are. That you don't have what it takes to succeed in life. That the right opportunities will never come to you. Maybe somebody else, but not you. And that the problem you're facing is completely unfixable. But we must remember that nothing is impossible with God. And nothing is impossible with him that believes. It's that place of believing that you challenge those problems. To be problem-minded is not the best, healthiest mindset for you, whether it's your marriage or a relationship or whatever you're facing this morning. And the enemy has sometimes endeavored to convince us that our problem is just too big to be fixable, too big for an answer. And the reason is because we can't figure it out. Boy, we give ourselves a lot of credit, don't we? But the Bible says, trust in the Lord with all of your what? Heart. Lean not to your own understanding. But it's our understanding that we're often battling with because we can't figure it out. It isn't that there isn't a solution. There is a solution to conquering and defeating and breaking through that problem. But it's not in your mind, it's in the mind of Christ. And yet, the Bible says, we have the mind of Christ and hold the thoughts, feelings, the purposes of his heart. You see, the doctor's report might have come to you. I'm not denying the doctor's report and how it reads and what the prognosis is. Your bank book or bank account might say, this is where you're at in your life. Or your marriage might seem or feel it's absolutely impossible forever to resolve a situation. Or your mistake that you know of and everyone else knows of is so big, is so large, is so just beyond imagination that there just is nothing, you know, that can bring an answer to that. But I want to remind everyone in this room, God always has a remedy. God always has an answer. God is always ready to restore. God is always ready to bring the solution to your life, regardless of what the adversary is trying to plague you with right now. And I want you to be assured in this room that hard times are not as hard as they look. Because if you're just looking with the dark mind, with a problem mindset, the moment you begin to look at it from God's perspective, here comes the light. And the light is a resolution. And God always has a triumph for his people. God loves people. You know, one of the tactics that the adversary has used, which I have seen in my course of being a pastor, is his most aggressive is the feelings of rejection. Especially when it comes to relationship or when it comes to being sometimes directed or corrected or it comes to the job in a relationship, you know, the feelings of rejection. Why I throw the word feelings in it? Because oftentimes it may be directly rejection, but sometimes it's just how we feel about it. You got to be careful about your feelings. They could end up lying to you. Yeah. But the point is this. Rejection is very damaging to the soul. And I kind of grew up in the in a household where that was, you know, pretty prominent. But the point I'm trying to share with you is that rejection can damage your soul. When I say soul, I mean your mind, your will, and your emotions. My pastor, Pastor Cesar, has taught me well on this level. And it's why we had an encounter last week. But when rejection comes, you know, what rejection does, it rocks your personal confidence in that relationship, in that covenant situation. It can shake the foundation of what you once were assured of. And it can be this, it can be, and this is what I said, it can be the seed of the spirit of distrust in your life. That's why I'm bringing it up. Rejection is the seed. Now, anyone in this room and everyone in this room can be healed from rejection. Unless you choose just to hold on to it.
But you don't know what they did to me.
You're right. I don't know what they did to you, but I know what it's doing to you. But I want to share this with you. If unhealed, that rejection will develop a root system. And that root system, like a seed, it's like a seed, it's planted. And that seed of rejection, we all face it, ladies and gentlemen. You're not the only person in the world that's ever faced rejection. But the enemy wants to isolate you and make you feel that nobody understands your situation. That your situation is way beyond all imagination. And I am not giving rejection a pass. Rejection can devastate. It can hurt you. It can hurt you, especially emotionally. It could damage your willpower. You become unwilling to do certain things because your soul has been damaged. But the root system that it begins to develop, it's so damaging, it begins to cause you to live hurt. And living hurt is the open door to hurting other people, consciously and subconsciously. Meaning being aware of it and not being aware of it. And as you well know, hurt people, what? Hurt people. Hurt people suppress it, but hurt people because of things they've gone through in their life. In a relationship, the potential of that happening will be there. The ability to not live hurt is our responsibility, meaning we can respond to it. We can resolve it. We don't have to live like damaged goods. Amen. Quiet in this holy Pentecostal place. But it's okay. I think the Spirit of God is sharing something with those of you listening, those on live stream, those on, you know, watching by Facebook. It's important that you understand why sometimes you do react to people. Why sometimes we are distrusting. It always has a root system. It always goes bad. Now, again, you have to understand, this doesn't make you a bad person, but sometimes we don't understand what everything's all tied into. And I think it's important that we understand this, and that the spirit of rejection has great, great damage upon our lives. But the collateral damage, what it does to other people, it doesn't make you the healthiest person, per se. I like the word that Jasmine used a few moments ago, that young life group leader that was up here. You can get into toxic relationships and not even know why. And it's not her story, but I just want you to understand this. And one of the biggest demonic lies that the adversary has ever put out there is that God rejects people for their weakness, for their sin, for their transgressions, for their mistakes, and their imperfections, and the list goes on, faults and failures. Couldn't be further from the truth. Because the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ is ultimately, in summary, a message of restoration. It is a message of healing. It is God not rejecting humanity. It's God coming to humanity to lift them and to heal them and to restore them. The message of Jesus Christ is a healing message. It is a message that will heal your soul. I see so many people walking like they're damaged goods, not just Christians, non-Christians, just to make a difference. And I want you to understand that I do understand sometimes sometimes people get a little, convoluted, get a little complex about certain things that are said. For example, when Jeremiah said this, he said, "This is what the Lord says. Your wounds are incurable and your injury is beyond healing." When Jeremiah spoke those words, he was speaking to a disobedient, unrepentant people who turned away from the answer for their lives, which was God. They deliberately did this because they wanted to worship other idols, live in their transgressions, not turn a pure heart towards God, get into false images and practices, and they just wanted to concoct their own, remedies and answers. And God said, as long as you keep that way, your wounds will be incurable and your injury beyond healing. What I want you to hear is, as long as a person doesn't trust God, there is no guarantee that your wounds will be healed. Or that your healing will come, or that, but I want to turn that around and absolutely, without any question, help you to understand that there is no injury that's incurable. There is no situation that cannot be healed. Child of God, let me tell you something. Our world is plagued with people who think that God does not love them, that God does not care for them, that God has nothing to do with them, because they say, "I know how I'm living. Why would God want to have anything to do with me?" For the same reason he had something to do with all of us. While we were yet sinners, yet Christ died for us on the cross to demonstrate his love for you and I. But the world does not know that. They don't understand that God is coming to you and to them because he is the healer. He is the restorer. The Bible prophesied, Psalms 107, that God would send his word, and deliver them and heal people. And I want you to understand today that there is a world, and sometimes there may even be religious people who want to know but don't know and really think, and why their minds are darkened and why they cannot see solutions is because in the back of their mind, they think because of what the doctor said, or because what some preacher said, or because of, this person said, because of what I've been through, my situation, my wound is incurable and my injury is beyond healing. And that's exactly what the adversary wants you to believe. And I'm here to tell you, no, that is not true. Jesus came to heal you and me and everybody who would trust in him. Say, there's healing for me. In fact, in Jeremiah 33, verse 6, and I get some of this from my pastor as he was ministering this week in his devotion. But it goes on in Jeremiah 33, verse 6, it says, "Nevertheless," Jeremiah continues to say, "I will bring health and healing to it, and I will heal my people, and will let them enjoy abundant peace and security." See, for a people who turn to God, there is healing. Say, healing. Healing. Say, there's healing in the name of Jesus. That's why I love Easter, because to the world, to some people, the cross is foolishness to them. But to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. It was on that cross that he took our place so that we can live a life that we never thought we could live. You see, he is the one who loves us back to life. Come on, somebody, put your hands together for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I want you to know that, I want to remind you as I close here, that the assault of rejection is an effect on our self-esteem and our self-worth and, you know, confidence. I'm talking about healthy confidence, healthy self-esteem. You know, the emotional attack and the damage that it does. What he's saying that there are things that you in your own strength and in your own might and your own willpower will never be able to recover from on your own. Trusting in yourself. And thank God for anything that medical science can do. Thank God they've kept us alive, Shandai. You know, but I want you to understand, some of you think that time will heal you. Time will not heal you. And distance will not heal you. What do you mean by that? Running away from a relationship. Just taking off and bucking it, going this way, that, and the other, and say, like, I'm just going to get as far away as I can. Well, you can go as far as you can. But if you keep on going, you're going to end up in the same place. But I want you to understand that there's not enough time and there's not enough distance to heal you. There isn't. But there's always enough Jesus. And I'm not saying that if you're a young believer here in this room, I'm not saying that, you know, to be religious. Well, you're supposed to say that. I'm saying that because I've been the healed many times over in every category of life, spirit, soul, and body. Thank you. But I want you to understand this. The great story is a story of that he mentions of the Good Samaritan. We've read it before. I'm just going to make reference to it because of time here. But Jesus told the parable of the Good Samaritan, a man who was attacked by thieves and left half dead. In one sense, you can look at him. He was left in the side of the road, the middle of the road, and there he was. This is in Luke chapter 10. You can reference it later on. But it's the story of one man coming to a rejected individual and bringing healing to that individual. The inflictors left him half dead, left him so injured, and then they simply walked away. In one sense, in the sense of what I'm sharing with you right now, you know, it is like reject. How many of us, or how many people, you may know somebody who was broken up, tore up, messed up from the floor up, you know, in a relationship, and then that person who promised them everything just walked away. And that person is left with the bag of carrying all of that emotion. They don't know how to put that together. And but here's someone who came to the aid of someone else who was injured by wicked people, by wickedness itself, and then left in his pain, discarded, left alone, rejected, left behind, marginalized, and everyone walked away. And I think it's important that you understand that Jesus is telling this story, and I'm just giving you a portion of the story. Jesus is telling this story because he's answering, he's bringing an astounding answer to people. A person who asked them, who is my neighbor that I should take care of him? And Jesus begins to share with him. He says, there was this good Samaritan. And when the Levite and the priest came by, the priest being the religious order, religion, rituals, and routines could not heal him. And the Levite, which is representative, symbolic of works, our works cannot heal us. And they walked by the man who was left half dead because they could not do anything for that man. And that man was still dying. Who knows that he thought maybe he was going to pass away. But then Jesus said, then there was a good Samaritan who walked by and stopped. And maybe he had a satchel, or maybe he had a pouch. And he opened up the pouch and he had two jars. One had oil and one had wine. The Bible says that the good Samaritan stopped, came directly where that man was. I mean, like, as if on purpose, stopped with his busy life, bent over, and began to pour in the oil and the wine. And the wine is representative of the blood of Jesus, which is representative of salvation, which is representative of what's called the new birth. The oil, the wine could have been looked at as an antiseptic. The oil is like an ointment to soothe an injury. And the Bible says he poured in the oil and the wine, but the oil is symbolic of the Holy Spirit. And then in telling this story, and I'm hurrying it up, tells a story, he says, and that he lifted this man up, put him on his little burrito that he had, his donkey, and he took him to an inn, and he told the innkeeper, take care of him, and when I return, I shall repay you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the Good Samaritan was not just a good person doing good works. Jesus was talking about himself. He's the one who comes in and heals injuries that seem incurable. He's the one who comes and brings healing that seems like it's beyond any healing. But it takes the oil, God's salvation, and the wine, the work of the Holy Spirit. Jesus was talking about himself. Jesus was talking about the church. Jesus was talking about his love for humanity. When Jeremiah said, nevertheless, I will bring health and healing to them. I will heal my people. I will heal my people, and I will let them enjoy the abundant peace and security. I understand, brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers, husbands and wives, those of you in relationships, that sometimes we get in such conflict that the problem just looks so dark. But God wants to give you light for your heart, because the gospel message is a restoring message, and for the hearts of others. It's time for all of us, as the Holy Spirit reveals to you, to let the Holy Spirit encounter you. Let him pour into you the oil and the wine so that you would be restored by his great grace. Did you receive something this morning? Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a great big hand clap.